looking for something. A new way, a new understanding, a connection, some comfort. You've got questions, and Light on Living puts the spotlight on all the answers so you can shine. Lift and lighten the load of life's challenges and learn simple and easy ways to live a healthy, happy life. You'll gain insight and start to see things in a new way that motivates you. You're invited to hear new, see different, and feel more as Lisa shines the light on living.
Well, hello, everybody. Welcome to Light on Living. I'm Light Coach Lisa, holistic nutritionist and life coach, helping to lighten the load of life's challenges.
Well, today's show makes me feel like we are all going to be given a crystal ball for our health, that is. And today we're going to be talking about diseases that have no symptoms. It's kind of scary. And six conditions that have almost no symptoms until it's too late. So today I would love for you to be able to walk away feeling empowered and in control of your health and learn new ways that could really put you on top of your health game. And to do just that, we have natural health expert, Dr. Christine Horner, MD, award-winning author of Radiant Health, Ageless Beauty, and leading expert in natural health. She is accredited with launching a five-year crusade called the Breast Reconstruction Advocacy Project, the BRA Project, that led to the passage of an unprecedented federal law that was signed by President Bill Clinton in 1998, requiring insurance companies to pay for breast reconstruction following a mastectomy. So I'd like to welcome Dr. Horner, and wow, what a topic we have for today.
Well, thank you. It's so great to be with you again.
Yes, yes. The last show that we had, it was just like, I never wanted it to end. There was so much to learn and hear. And this one really, you're going to really be helping us out because when, like, I feel like that's what it's like. It's like a crystal ball that we can look into and say, like, it's kind of scary knowing that there are diseases that don't have any symptoms.
Well, you know, yeah, and particularly the ones we're going to be talking about today are ones that are, you know, potentially deadly. So, it's really important to get educated about them and know what you can do to help prevent them.
Yes, exactly. So you've got some good ones on the list there. But okay, so I don't know if you just want you. We don't want to just build all of them right now. But let's start with this first one that maybe that you find that so many people have that we just don't know.
Sure. So the first one is having high blood pressure, and that's actually got the nickname of being the silent killer because most of the time people have absolutely no awareness that they have it. And the danger of it is that if you have long-standing high blood pressure, it's something that really significantly increases your risk of developing heart disease and strokes and also kidney disease. So what the recommendation is to see your doctor at least once a year, kind of that well checkup. If it turns out that you do have some high blood pressure, it's kind of a good idea to check your blood pressure on a regular basis. So you can actually get one of those automated kind of blood pressure cuffs, online, and it's really inexpensive, so you can check your own. All the things that we're going to talk about today, they all are related to lifestyle and everything else, turns out that it is. So, we find that people who develop high blood pressure as well as the other things we're discussing, generally they have, poor diet, eating processed foods and carbs and being overweight and, drinking too much and smoking and, not exercising and all those kinds of things. So in order to reverse it, obviously it's really important to do healthy diet and lifestyle changes, and that's actually the focus of my latest book, which is called Radiant Health, Ageless Beauty, and it's all about how to create extraordinary health and longevity. All the details, are there. But another interesting thing about high blood pressure is that there's a very strong association with stress.
Yeah.
So, stress actually plays a huge role in virtually every chronic disease, but particularly high blood pressure. So in ancient cultures, like in traditional Chinese medicine and Ayurveda, which originates from India, they realized 5,000 plus years ago that stress played a key role in all these different kinds of chronic diseases. And so they created these effective stress-reducing techniques. So in India, mostly it was meditation, and China, everybody's seen all those huge numbers of people out in the courtyards in the morning practicing Qigong and Tai Chi, you know, yoga, those kinds of things. And they've actually been found to be unbelievably effective in lowering the risk of chronic disease. And it does it in a number of different ways, but basically what you're doing is kind of training your nervous system to not be as reactive, so it's not producing dangerous cortisol and other stress hormones to the degree that it would normally. One practice every day.
Yes. I'm going to stop you there for just a second, because just so everybody's following, okay, people know what stress is. They get that. That's all. That's we know what that is. But what, if we were to walk through the stress response, because you mentioned cortisol and, you know, the nervous system. So, like, we could get stressed quickly and easily. Like, it's a pretty fast thing. Do we instantly get high blood pressure from, you know, being frustrated at some point? Or is this a, like, can you walk us through the stress response?
Yeah, so actually, it was kind of interesting is that, and I kind of call it a design flaw. There's a number of design flaws. But, you know, if we have any kind of stress that happens in our life, and it could be something really serious, like let's say you're trying to cross the street and a car was pushing and you've got to, you know, really run out of the way quick. Or if you just have those minor things, say you open a credit card bill and it's higher than you think it should be.
Right.
Our bodies will always respond exactly the same way. It's called the flight or fight response.
Right.
And the stresses that we are subjected to, the vast majority of them, this day and age, are ones we're fighting or are running away, are not appropriate responses.
Right.
So what happens is that if we have something that we consider a stress, and actually the father of research and stress with Hans Selye. And so he kind of defines stress as a psychophysiological reaction that happens internally. So it's actually, there's nothing out there. You can say nothing inherently out there is stressful. For instance, you know, I'm a professional public speaker, so that never stresses me out. It's one of the number one freak outs for people, right? So
yes.
Different things stress different people out, and it's all kind of an internal perception, you know, of how you have that. And then it causes this neurochemical cascade that's a very kind of coordinated response. And it affects your adrenal glands that sit on top of your kidneys, and they secrete numerous different types of hormones, the adrenaline, the norepinephrine is the thing that gives us that fight or flight response, so we have enough energy to kind of jump out of the way or chase or, you know, get away from somebody chasing us. And then cortisol is the stress hormone, which the function of it in that immediate fight or flight response is that it actually causes your muscles to get its energy from itself, because that's the most efficient way to get your muscles to work very quickly. And so it actually shuts down the ability to bring glucose into the cells. Now, if you have cortisol chronically, which is not meant to be in a situation, that does is it causes your cells to become insulin resistant, it causes your blood sugar levels to go up, it increases your risk of diabetes, high blood pressure, you know, all that kind of stuff. So, again, it's just like we're recognizing that kind of all day long, we're having all sorts of different kinds of things that stress us. And for most people, keeping their cortisol levels kind of at this high elevated state, and all the chronic diseases that we commonly see in our culture are very much tied to the stress response.
So in that case, I love that you said that, because, like, if you can imagine, like, everybody goes through these emotional things, whether it's worry, blame, frustration, scared, you know, all those things that cause that stress response. And our bodies are constantly, I love that you used the word chemical cascade. So we're going through this all day, and usually a healthy body, like what you talked about in the beginning with a healthy lifestyle, we're able to find that balance, like our body can come down. But, and you mentioned too, the way the Ayurveda, the in India, they do theirs through meditation, maybe, or the Qigong and Tai Chi. What is it about doing, let's say Tai Chi, I think a lot of people know that. What is it about doing Tai Chi that is helping to alleviate the stress or put it back into balance?
Well, actually, all of those techniques, and I've practiced transcendental meditation for about 25 years now, all of them do kind of the same thing, where, again, what it's doing is it's training your nervous system to not be as reactive. So when you're spending, those particular techniques are all things that are extremely calming, and they actually can put your brain into different brainwave activity. That's kind of a distinct type of consciousness. And so when you have the stresses in life, you know, relationship stuff, the bills, whatever, you know, you open up and you're like, oh, well, it's not that big of a deal. Or, you know, and a good way to look at it, too, is that, so let's say you start out in the morning, and the moment you wake up, you just think the day is horrible, everything's going wrong. And in that moment, you are escalating the level of stress. And so everything else that happens from there, even if it's a minor stuff, it can seem like it's major because you're just in an escalated state. So it's kind of the reverse of that, where when you're kind of calmed through that process of some effective stress reducing techniques, then these things can happen, and it's, you know, when you're just calm and everything is going, well, you know, it's not that big of a deal, or, you know, whatever, but it can't be truly, yeah, and it's not like you're consciously thinking about reacting to it differently. It's just something that you naturally do because your physiology is in a much more relaxed state.
Right. So let's say somebody that's listening right now, and they are thinking, oh my gosh, that's me. I wake up every morning, I am stressed or uncomfortable, and I don't know if I have high blood pressure or not. So let's say they go down to, I mean, here where I am, our drugstores have those cuffs. You can sit down and you put your arm in there and it gives you a reading. Can you walk us through how would we read the blood pressure ourselves? Because, you know, what happens if I'm nervous and now is my blood pressure going to be affected right away? Or like how many times does it take for me to kind of get a handle on reading my blood pressure?
Right. Well, you know, the thing is, if you have a thing we call white coat hypertension, which means when you go into your doctor, you instantly are feeling anxious and it causes your blood pressure to go up. So you get kind of an artificially high, you know, reading. And so you can actually get blood pressure tests like on Amazon.com and, you know, do it at home. And so the recommendation is that before you take your blood pressure, you want to be in a super calm, no activity, no eating or drinking hot food, nothing for 30 minutes ahead of time. So you can get yourself into this more relaxed state, and then you take your blood pressure. And so obviously it's something you want to repeat multiple times to kind of get the accurate reading with it, but the importance of it is that ideally you want to be in a super relaxed state when you take it.
Okay, and so does everybody have the exact same kind of, like, maybe is it normal, could I have higher blood pressure than another person but still be healthy? Like, it's like a pulse?
Sure, so we have parameters, yeah, parameters that we use, and in the past we used to say 140 over 90. If anything was higher than 140 over 90, you had high blood pressure, and ideally you wanted it less than, you know, 120 or, you know, 80. So now the American Heart Association actually changed their recommendation last year. And so they changed it from 140 over 90 to 130 over 80. And in doing that, the estimates are now that about 50% of adult Americans have high blood pressure, and about 50% of those people don't know it.
Oh, my gosh. That's a lot.
Yeah.
How much of a role does sodium play? Like the bad sodium.
Actually controversial for some people. It's an issue, and for other people, it's not so much. But it's kind of the idea that you're not doing too much salt in the pot and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, those are the things that really wreck havoc and that, you know, hurt their bodies. And another really simple thing that people can do is to really focus on gratitude. I mean, it's kind of amazing where the research has found that people who are feeling grateful, right, you know, a technique is waking up in the morning and thinking about the things that you're grateful for, and that really affects you throughout your day. They even make, cards that you can get that are pre-printed things. You can put a little bowl. I got one of those cards each morning, and you use kind of an uplifting message in it, and it really does have an effect on you throughout the day.
Oh my goodness, that's so beautiful. Now, I think I must have the lowest blood pressure because I think everything is beautiful and uplifting.
Yay.
Here's a question. So actually, this just happened yesterday. A friend of the family called, and they have had a lot of pain in their leg, and the doctor had found a blood clot in the back of their knee, and they had to have emergency surgery, like literally yesterday that happened. So is that something to do? Do blood clots have to do with high blood pressure?
Generally not. I mean, that a lot of times has something to do with some abnormal clotting factor. And actually not exercising. If you're sitting on a plane or sitting for a long period of time, I mean, that's something that can cause your blood to kind of, you know, stagnate and, you know, potentially clot like that. So another, you know, thing about making sure that you exercise daily.
Yes.
Yeah.
The movement and getting the flow going. And that says a lot too, but I love that you said the word stagnation, because you're right. Like it certainly wouldn't help if you were stagnant, had clotting factors, and then had high blood pressure and didn't know.
That's right.
Okay, so and then we have 1 minute before going to commercial, or 30 seconds here, but just to wrap the blood pressure up. So definitely monitoring it, and is there any other symptoms? Like, there's just no symptoms, so they wouldn't know until they monitor it.
Well, for the most part, you don't have any symptoms unless it's astronomically high. And if that happens, then, of course, you could have headaches and dizziness and shortness of breath. Yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay. So those are, yeah, and then that way you've gone too far. This is crazy pants. You've got to do something about it. And what about just on that one? Is there medication? Well, okay, we might have to go to commercial, but I am going to ask if there is medication we should be taking when we come back.
Best of the holistic, spiritual, and conscious world. OMTimes Radio, IOM FM.
Humanity Healing International is a small nonprofit with a big dream. Since 2007, HHI has been working tirelessly to bring help to communities with little or no hope. Our projects are not broad mandates, nor are they overnight solutions, but they bring the reassurance that no one is alone and that someone cares. To learn more, please visit humanityhealing.org. Humanity Healing is where your heart is.
My name is Victor Furman. Some call me The Voice. I've always been fascinated with human nature, spirituality, science, and the crossroads at which they meet. Join me Wednesdays at 8 p.m. Eastern on OM Times Radio, and we'll explore these topics and so much more on Destination Unlimited.
Welcome back to The Cat Show. Up next, we have Nico. Nico is a member of the Shelter Pet Group.
That's right. A group known especially for their sunspot sleeping, ball chasing, leg rubbing, and of course, companionship. Just look how she struts.
It's like she owns the place.
And see how she curls up and cuddles her person.
The pitch on her purring is simply perfect.
Nice one.
Fantastic cat. But really the best way to know an amazing shelter pet like Nico is to meet one.
Visit theshelterpetproject.org today. Adopt.
Brought to you by Maddie's Fund, the Humane Society of the United States, and the Ad Council.
And we're back here learning so much about how we can literally jump onto our health and really take it to another level of and through such ease. And we have natural health expert Dr. Christine Horner, MD, award-winning author of Radiant Health, Ageless Beauty, here with us. And I want to wrap up. You're talking about high blood pressure and how that really is something that, like you said, 50% of Americans have and 50% of them don't know. Once we have it, you've given us some incredible ways, easy, effective, natural ways of taking down that blood pressure. But is there a time when we should be going on medication or have to go on medication for high blood pressure?
Well, yeah, I mean, there's certain people that get themselves into a crisis situation and absolutely need to be on medications. But, you know, ideally you really want to correct your diet, lifestyle, all the things that we talked about, and that can, you know, ultimately cause you to lower your blood pressure and maybe not have to take medications.
Yes, wouldn't that be nice? And I know, I don't know if you'll know the exact stats, but I remember hearing one time that for every prescription that we do take in general, that there's generally 3 to 7 side effects of that prescription.
Oh, yeah. You know, there's tons of side effects. So it's like if you can just keep yourself healthy, you can avoid them.
Yeah, exactly. And that's why this is so cool that you're letting us know these other ones. So we've got high blood pressure. What's another one, another one of those 5 diseases that have literally all of those?
Well, so another one is something we don't like to talk about, but it's sexually transmitted diseases. So actually HPV, the human papillomavirus, is the most common sexually transmitted disease. 70% of people that are sexually active will be exposed to it at some point in their lifetime. The good news is that if you get that virus, that your own immune system can get rid of it 98% of the time.
Oh, my God.
So
So
only 2% of people do they go on to get a chronic infection. And if you do get that chronic infection, there's actually no effective Western treatments that can get rid of that virus, you know, if you have it. So the really exciting news is that there's some new research that just came out of the University of Texas Health Sciences that looked at a mushroom formula called AHCC. And AHCC has been around for decades, and they've actually done quite a bit of research on it in clinical trials, and they found that it's the most effective formula in helping to support your immune system. So our immune system is really what keeps us healthy. It has all the cells in there that go out and look for bacteria and viruses and cancer cells and help to destroy them. And so if you have a really healthy immune system, you pretty much don't get sick.
Right.
So, AHCC is something that's been shown to be the most effective immune-supporting formula, and they actually prescribe it in the hospitals in Japan if you get cancer because it improves the survival statistics so much. But then they've tested it for a number of other things, and what they did here in the United States at University of Texas Health Sciences is they tested AHCC against the HPV virus, and they found in the laboratory that it actually killed the virus.
Wow.
And so then they did a pilot study where they took women that had this chronic HPV infection. Again, there's no effective Western treatment. Most of the time people are just constantly have to go into their gynecologist and have topical stuff done and surgeries and that kind of thing. So they gave women with a chronic HPV infection the AHCC, and they kept them on relatively high dose of some 3 grams a day for 6 months. And they found that people who took the AHCC for 6 months or longer, that in the vast majority of them, it completely eradicated that virus. For the first time, not anything, you know, that will do that. Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. And so that's a mushroom base. Like, so we know mushrooms are immunologic.
Yeah. So AHCC is actually an extract that comes from certain types of shiitake mushrooms. And the thing that makes this formula different over other mushroom formulas is that usually they're using constituents that are out of the cap of the mushroom. And this is a particular plant chemical basically that's extracted from the roots of it, or the mycelium of them. And they're processing it. The molecules are made really small. And most mushroom molecules are these big, huge, you know, molecules. And so they actually absorb them to our system more effectively and is more what we call bioavailable. So that's one of the things that really helps with its effectiveness.
And is that something we can get, whether it's in North America or...
Yeah, so AHCC, it's a base ingredient that's from Japan, but all of the supplements that carry it here in the U.S. Use that same, you know, compound, so it's not like the quality of it is different. You know, you'll find the same thing in a variety of different supplements. But I personally take one that's made from Quality of Life Labs out of New York, and it's a pure AHCC supplement. And so you can just Google it. I mean, the best place to do it is to get it online. And I actually have like a little online store on my website.
Ooh,
and so I
yeah.
carry the AACC there too. Yeah.
Okay. And that's going to be Dr. Christine Horner, HORNER.com. And it's clicking mm-hmm. with a C. And I was just going to ask you, you had mentioned something about they did studies on cancer. Would this be something that would help also with cancer?
Yeah, actually, they found that it lowers the risk of many different kinds of cancers, such as breast cancer, prostate cancer, liver cancer. Even looks like it might be helpful in reducing the risk of melanoma. And then, like I said, they've found that it is very effective while people are going through cancer treatments. Mm-hmm. It seems to take away a lot of the side effects of chemotherapy and also significantly improve survival statistics. So that's why it's prescribed in the hospitals in Japan. Yeah.
Yes, that's huge,
mm-hmm.
actually, because, yes,
yeah.
we do know that when you have cancer, even the first time, like the second time, it just gets worse. So this is something I'll be looking at more. I want to ask you, when it comes to the HPV virus then, they do a lot, they really do promote in schools of getting that vaccine. I'm against it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just publicly against
yeah.
all vaccines. But
right.
So this is almost kind of saying, when you just said 70% of us are exposed to it, but 98% of our own immune systems can get rid of it. So is there a need?
I think if you, I mean, first of all, you can give HPV to your teenagers and all it's going to do is cause them to be healthier, and the vaccine, you know, I think is very controversial for many different reasons. I mean, one is that we're treating, doing this mass treatment for something that barely doesn't affect very many people. Because, like I said, if you keep your immune system strong, I mean, basically you're wiping it out on your own and you don't need a vaccine for it. And it's a very small percentage of people that go on to have a chronic infection, and then a small percentage of those that, you know, go on to have cervical cancer. So the risk is not that impressive.
Right.
And, you know, there's a lot of controversy about that vaccine because it's considered the vaccine that has the most adverse reactions to it. There's like a center where you, you know, report the adverse reactions, and it's the number one reported one, and which also includes permanent neurological problems and even death. And it's like, boy, you know, I don't know if I want to take that risk for something that, you know, you have a really low risk of having a chronic disease with. And now we truly have this effective, you know, formula that can eradicate it. So it's like, well, can't be taking HPV.
Well, thank you for sharing.
Vaccine.
And thank you for sharing that, because sometimes I feel like, you know, some of the diseases, quote unquote, that we're actually getting and suffering from are the ones that we're actually taking and consuming. So that
right.
And just a side question about that too. A lot of people will have cold sores or warts. I know those are two different things. Is anything
mm-hmm.
related? If somebody shows up and they go, oh, I have a wart or I have a cold sore, does it mean that they have something even more, like a silent?
Well, there's actually about 100 different strains of human papillomavirus. And so some of them don't cause anything. Some of them cause venereal warts. Some of them, you know, cause cervical cancer. And so there's certain, you know, strains that are considered more kind of high risk. The vast majority of them, you know, don't do anything. The cold sores are actually herpes virus. It's a different kind of a virus.
Right.
And it's not the human papillomavirus. So there's, a bunch of different viruses out there.
Okay, so we definitely, there's another. So should we, A, do any kind of testing to find out if we have an HPV, or do we just, you know what, get on that AHCC immune system formula, the extract, and just do ourselves a favor and improve our immune system?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a good thing. Now, in women, this is another one, like I said, there's no symptoms, you know, normally with it. Unless you have the variety that's the venereal warts that we're talking about, primarily the one that causes cervical cancer. So there's no symptoms with it. In women, you can actually diagnose HPV by doing pap smears. So that's the way you can monitor things. And actually, since we started doing pap smears, the incidence of cervical cancer dropped by 70% because, you know, there was interventions that, you know, are occurring if you got some abnormal cells that kind of prevented it. In men, there's actually no good test for testing for HPV, which causes, as doctors, some more, you know, clinical challenges with it. So Again, I just think it all comes down to making yourself as healthy as you possibly can. And then I started taking AHCC maybe about 5 years ago, I think, when I first heard about it. And I just think it's an excellent overall preventative health, formula to take. Keeping yourself as healthy as you can is the key.
I love that. And they say mushrooms can help heal the world. So I'm up for it. Thumbs up on my side. So we got that one. So I had those down as some. Now, what is the third one that people are dealing with but don't even have a clue because they're not having any symptoms?
Right. So pancreatic cancer is actually the next one. Okay. And, this one's really notorious where, if you start having symptoms, then it's generally too late. I mean, it's very silent. The pancreas is really deep. It's really kind of against our back, behind the stomach area. So you can't feel anything there. There's no screen tests, that are done for it. It used to be fairly uncommon, but this is kind of an odd cancer where we're noticing that the incidence of it is really increasing like crazy. A lot of other cancers, like breast cancer, stayed pretty stable for the last, couple of decades, and other ones were actually having a decrease. But pancreatic cancer is one where we're seeing a significant increase, and they're actually expecting it to increase by 50% for the next decade or so.
What the heck is causing that?
Well, again, diet, lifestyle, plays a role. Now, when I was a surgeon, we had no idea what caused pancreatic cancer, and it was pretty rare. I mean, as a surgeon, general surgeon and good surgeries, on pancreatic cancer, but it was extremely rare. I mean, I probably only did a couple of cases my whole 5 years of residency, and now it's much more common. And back then, we had no idea what caused it, and we just thought it was a matter of bad luck. But now we've discovered that there's all sorts of linkages to diet and lifestyle. So smoking and drinking alcohol in particular seems to really escalate it. People who are alcoholics and have had numerous bouts of pancreatitis, which is the inflammation of the pancreas, they have a much higher incidence of developing it. Being overweight, eating high fat, high sugar, foods, having diabetes, can increase it. And then really interestingly, they did the study looking at the relationship of drinking colas. So these are,
soda pop,
that's the dark color, colas. Okay. So that many means. So basically what they found is that, if you look at them, you think there's no nutritional value in this, but worse than that, it's really poisonous for us. And it has numerous bad effects on our health, but they found that people who drink more than two colas a week, and I know people who drink, 10 a day, two colas a week, it statistically significantly increases your risk of pancreatic cancer.
Oh my gosh, that's that poisonous. Yeah. And I believe that. That's absolutely just it's gross to me. I'm like, oh my God, increase. Two a week, and sometimes people maybe, and this is worse, some people don't even drink pop, let's say, through the week, but on a Friday they might have a Coke and a cola, what do you call them? Like an alcoholic drink with a mixed drink. That's what I'm trying to say. I'm looking for a
drink. Yeah.
And then you're going to have like at least a two. So that's actually good to know. So some of our lifestyle choices or just habits, we think it's not that bad at all. Those tiny, like you're saying, significantly increases the statistics of getting.
It's not a health drink.
Can we recover from pancreatic cancer? Is that something that,
let me tell you, it's really rare. So in people who are diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, we always do this thing where it's called a five-year survival, so that the percentage of people that will live 5 years with pancreatic cancer is only 5%.
Oh, dear. Okay.
So this is one you really want to try to avoid. And, the great thing is, like I said years ago, we thought it was just bad luck. And so then you're feeling like there's nothing you can do about it. But there is something you can do about it. Don't drink, lose weight.
Yeah.
How do we screen for that? Is there a way to, like, if I said, oh, you know what? I'd like to go see what the shape of my pancreas is in. Like, is there a way of doing that?
Actually, I mean, you can do ultrasounds and CAT scans and MRI scans and everything. But what they found is when they were looking at, okay, did it make a difference? Was it really expensive tests and things to do? The ultrasounds a little cheaper. But did it make a difference in pancreatic cancer mortality? And the answer was no. So that's why there's no recommendation to do annual screenings or anything for it.
Oh, wow. Okay, that is really scary, though.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. It's so weird. We just don't know. There's no crystal ball on that one. Oh, gosh.
Well, and like I said, you know, there's a huge association between drinking excess alcohol, smoking cigarettes, eating high carbs, having diabetes, you know. So you do have control in lowering your risk of that disease as well as every other kind of disease, too, by making the healthiest types of diet and lifestyle choices.
Okay. So, yeah, this is sounding like this is definitely the way to go. I was going to ask that. So, and I just want to say, for pancreas, for people who are just knowing that, that works really in conjunction with our glucose and our sugar and our insulin levels.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and cancer, if you could, in 1 minute or less, if we talk about cancer, cancer's not like a disease. Cancer is the malformation or something gone wrong in cells that replicate. Is that a fair enough kind of blanket statement?
Well, I would just say kind of in general, what happens is the cells or whatever tissue it is, they start to grow out of control. I mean, we normally have our cells that split and regenerate themselves, and so there's a problem kind of thing. Ultimately, it comes to kind of a genetic, you know, issue that develops that causes your cells to continue to grow rather than shutting off. And they become really kind of amorphous looking rather than these well-defined structures and stuff. Right. They're more amorphous looking, yeah.
Okay, that's helpful. Okay, because we are going to have to slip off to commercial in about 30 seconds, but we still have two or so more to come to find out what are some silent symptoms before we can find out. So let's everybody come back and we'll find out what's going on in our bodies and how we can fix it.
The best of holistic, spiritual, and conscious world. OMTimes Radio. IOM FM.
Ascending Hearts is no ordinary dating site, but a spiritual dating site with a purpose, to link you with your soulmate. We engineer the serendipity so you can trust that you will attune with someone that has the same matching vibration as you. Ascending Hearts, the conscious dating site for the spiritually aware. Try Ascending Hearts for free, ascendinghearts.com.
Grab a cup of tea or a glass of wine and tune in for Inspired Conversations with publisher Linda Joy on Tuesdays at 2 p.m. Eastern. Linda creates sacred space for leading female luminaries, empowering authors, heart-centered female entrepreneurs, coaches, and healers. A soulful venue where guests openly share the fears and obstacles they've overcome, wisdom and lessons learned, and the personal journey that led them to the transformational work they do in the world. Inspired Conversations, to empower you on your path to authentic, soulful living.
So I'm a cat, and I just moved in with this new human. And she's got this little toy she's always playing with all day long. Tap, 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 bloop, bloop. She can't put it down. There it is. Oh, and get this. She even talks to it. Last week, she asked it for Chinese. And guess what? Egg rolls showed up like magic. Humans have cool toys.
A person is the best thing to happen to a shelter pet. Be that person. Adopt. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the ShelterPetProject.org.
All right, we are here with Dr. Christine Horner, MD, award-winning author of Radiant Health, Ageless Beauty. I just love the title of that book. and it's so true, because all of these things that we're talking about, when we do have that radiant health and we can achieve that ageless beauty, it's by doing what you're talking about, the lifestyle, the food, the exercises, like all these things. But there certainly are some things that creep up and we can stay on top of. And so we just were talking about pancreatic cancer and the health of the pancreas, which kind of leads us into another one that you're going to bring up, which starts the letter D. How would one know with diabetes if they're even on that path or not?
Well, so diabetes is, there's actually two major types of it. Type 1, which generally happens earlier in life, and it's thought to be maybe due to a virus or bacteria that destroys the beta cells in the pancreas, so you don't produce insulin. Now, only 10% of people have that type. 90% of people with diabetes have type 2, and that particular type is associated very strongly with obesity. So too many calories, being overweight, a lot of, sugar and carbs, of course, smoking is another thing that, increases the risk, but mostly it's, lack of exercise and eating much is a general thing. And so if you lose weight and start exercising and stuff, it's extremely responsive. I mean, people will have an unbelievable improvement in their diabetes. A lot of times their symptoms completely go away and they don't need to be on any medications anymore. But it's really become this epidemic. And now the statistics are that one-fourth of all adults over the age of 65 in the United States have diabetes type 2. So it's like a crazy thing. And, of course, we're now seeing type 2 in younger kids because there's obesity in our children now that like we've never seen before. And we're really relating this to the sugar and the carbs is the worst thing for our bodies and the thing that puts fat on us the most. And then, of course, not exercising. And another really kind of interesting little known fact about helping to prevent diabetes is there's a strong link with your risk of developing diabetes and your vitamin D levels.
So your what story?
Vitamin D.
Vitamin D. Oh, okay.
Vitamin D, yeah. So there's just really a huge amount of research going on about vitamin D in the last decade or so, and we've discovered that it works in the body more like a hormone rather than like a vitamin. And it's essential for every cell in the body for it to function properly. When it's low, which it's estimated to be low in 80% of Americans, if it's low, then it significantly increases your risk of a number of different diseases, including blood pressure, that we talked about. It can increase your risk of pancreatic cancer, but it also really increases your risk of diabetes. So if your levels are lower than 30, then your risk of developing diabetes is 5 times higher than somebody who has their numbers in what's considered the therapeutic range. Now, there was a study that just came out, about a month ago at this point, where they really looked at delineating kind of the numbers, was it greater than 30? What happens if your vitamin D levels are greater than 50? Because ideally, you want them to be 40, 50, 60, kind of in that range. So they found if you had levels of vitamin D greater than 50, that your risk of diabetes went down by 80%.
Oh, wow.
So it's kind of astounding where you're thinking, gosh, you have all these horrible brand lifestyle, but you can significantly lower your risk by making sure that your vitamin D levels are in that therapeutic range, and also you lower your risk of many different kinds of diseases and cancers and breast cancer and so forth if your levels are up. So you need to get your levels checked, and you can get a doctor's office for that, or if you don't want to do that, you can actually order a kit. From the internet, there's a website called NutrientPower.org. And NutrientPower.org is run by a 501c3 organization. It's really focusing on a couple different nutrients, vitamin D as well as omega-3 fatty acids. And doing as intensive data collection, kind of studies looking at the various different vitamin D levels and the incidence of different kinds of diseases so that we fully understand like what the association is with those right now is vitamin D and omega-3 fatty acids with that. But they have a kit that you can order on their website. Again, nutrientpower.org. It just comes to your house. It has instructions. And basically what you're doing is pricking your finger and putting a little dot of blood on a piece of paper and sending it in. And then they can tell you what your levels are. And based on that, then you can adjust how much vitamin D you're taking. Most people need to take supplemental vitamin D. We need way more than what people used to think. The minimum requirement is usually 2,000 international units a day. Some people need 5,000. Some people need even more than that because it depends on how they metabolize it and what their state of health is. If you're in a disease state, usually you really have to take a whole lot more to get your vitamin D levels, you know, back up to that therapeutic range.
Right. And retesting is important, too, because we don't want people to go too far over either, because it is a fat-soluble vitamin. But it's so interesting how so many of us, we're just low in it. And so I love that you gave us those numbers. So lower than 30 is a not a good number. We want to aim for that
right.
40 to 50,
yeah.
And that we can actually yes. reduce the risk of diabetes by 80% by having it greater than 50.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have a really important question for you. So as a nutritionist, I sit with families, and a lot of families, and it's surprising actually, the parents will say about their children who are small children who are still, like say they're 6 years old, 5 years old, 10 years old, and they're still long and lean, and they're like, oh, they can handle the sugar. They're going to burn it off. So this really hurts my heart when I hear this, and it's so
yes.
a struggle. Like, just because we're thin doesn't mean we can have that sugar. Is that correct?
Yeah, that is correct. And actually, I mean, sugar acts like a poison in the human body. If you have a high sugary meal, they've shown that it just completely knocks out your entire immune system. So the function of the immune system will depress by 90% for 5 hours after having a high sugary meal. So it's extremely damaging. It causes a lot of inflammation in the body, and it's not safe. I don't care how much you weigh. It is not safe and definitely not something that you want to ingest.
Yeah. Okay. I'm going to play this part of the show over and over for people because it is because, you know, and a lot of people think sugar is just a fuel source and it can be burned and they're not recognizing that, like
right.
what you just said, that's huge. It depresses the immune system by 90% for the next 5 hours. This is so important for people to hear that. What was my question? Oh, goodness. There's so many good stuff here. I was watching. So as somebody loses weight and as their weight comes down, will they notice that their blood sugar levels are stabilizing just because of the weight loss?
Oh, yeah. I mean, and there's like a huge response that can happen. So even if your weight is up just a little bit, I mean, that can significantly increase your risk. And similarly, you don't have to lose that significant of weight to notice a really dramatic increase in your blood sugar level. So it is possible in very short order to get your blood sugar levels down to a more normal level when you start adopting healthy diet and lifestyle stuff and just losing a little bit of weight. Yeah.
Okay. And when's the best time to check our blood sugars?
Well, the normal recommendation is to do it in the morning. They do a fasting the blood sugar, so you don't eat anything after midnight, and then have the blood sugars checked in the morning.
Okay, and is that something could we order that from nutrientpower.org, or is that just for the vitamin D?
No, that's the blood sugar. Usually, you go to your doctor's office for that, or for diabetics, you know, they've got the, at-home devices where you can prick your finger and check your own blood sugar levels, but that's not through nutrientpower.org. So they're just looking at vitamin D levels and omega-3 fatty acid levels at this point, yeah.
Okay. And sorry, just one more thing on the sugar, because this is important. So as sugar, like sugar itself going into the body is, like what you said, it's poisonous. So whether we add fiber to it or protein to it or fats to it to bring down the level of insulin, is it just as dangerous for us?
Well, it does metabolize somewhat differently when you start adding fiber, which is only found in plants.
Yes.
And, it's a little safer. They actually have carb blockers, and then we had a white kidney bean extract that can be helpful too. But I mean, just as a general rule of thumb, I think it's a great idea just to try to avoid it as much as you possibly can and lose your taste buds, you know, for it too. Yeah.
Right. Yes, that's actually so true, because once you're used to having it, even other foods, you know, you feel like you want to add sugar to it. Or I found that once I added fermented foods or cultured foods into my diet, like a little bit more, not vinegary, but that taste of a vinegary kind of thing, it really curved. Like, I didn't even want anything sweet in my mouth because it doesn't taste nice. So it changes chemistry. So do we have another one more left for
So the last one is sleep apnea. And traditionally we think of this as kind of overweight strong man, you know, fat man disease. But sleep apnea is actually where you stop breathing. So it's not just snoring, it's where you actually stop breathing for several seconds. And the danger of it is that it really increases your risk of heart disease and strokes and, you know, other ill health. And really the only way, I mean, a lot of times a person who has a bed partner will say, hey, you stop breathing like that. So you'll know that a lot of people don't have bed partners that can tell them what's going on. And so the estimate is that 90% of people who have sleep apnea don't know it. I mean, it's like one of the more astronomical figures. And so again, you know, being overweight, eating too late at night, heavy meals, taking sleeping medications, drinking too much at night, all those things are things that, you know, help to contribute to sleep apnea. Okay. The only way it's really diagnosed is to go to a center where they do the sleep study. So you actually stay overnight at a place, and they got you hooked up to all these electrodes and everything, so they can really measure what's going on and you know, be able to kind of categorize it and that kind of thing. But if it's bad, they prescribe a machine called a CPAP machine, which it stands for continuous positive airway pressure.
Okay.
And it helps to keep your airway open. And then they also say raising your head up, you can sleep on a ledge, you know, kind of a thing, that helps. And again, losing weight, doing a good diet lifestyle, guess what? It improves the sleep apnea like crazy too.
So if somebody's snoring, then they are breathing because they're snoring.
Uh-huh.
Okay. So if I were to walk by the hall stairs when I hear somebody snoring, then I can be rest assured that they are not, you know, not breathing. And what is the dangers of, what was the dangers of, again, of if one does have sleep apnea?
So with sleep apnea, the problem is it's been shown to really increase your risk of heart disease and strokes, you know, in particular. And now the thing that you point out about the snoring too, so women, you know, will have sleep apnea. It's kind of interesting, a lot of times they don't snore, and so they don't have the same kind of symptoms as men, but they'll notice, like, in the morning, they may have kind of these vague headaches and daytime sleepiness, and so that's something that could potentially give you a clue that you might have that going on and would want to get checked out.
Because would sleep apnea then prevent you from going into those deep sleep? Well, I guess all the states of sleeping, like, you're being constantly interrupted. And
sure, right. You're not getting that deep sleep, and you're getting lack of oxygen because you're not breathing, you know, for several seconds. So there's lack of oxygen to your brain. And yeah, and it's actually even been shown to increase your risk of diabetes, you know, too. They're all kind of intertwined.
So it is, like, we've got our 2 minutes here, and I want to ask you, so these big ones here, like, these are in the book. Do you talk about this in the book right now, or?
So basically what I did with my latest book, Radiant Healthy Bone Beauty, is I focused on health. I did not focus on disease my previous book was called Vision the Warrior Goddess, was about everything that you need to do to lower your risk of breast cancer. But I thought it was really important to really focus on what do you need to do to create extraordinary health and longevity. And so it's all the different elements that are equally important. We so oftentimes focus on food, but, you know, there's things that are completely equally important that if you don't do, you're going to not have good health even if you're eating a great diet. So, you know, we got to exercise and sit for more than 5 hours a day. It significantly increases your risk of disease and lowers your longevity. Sleeping at the proper hours at the proper time is, you know, equally important to, you know, the type of foods that you eat. And it turns out of all the things that affect our health, more than diet, more than smoking, more than genetics, is our emotions. And to deal with the emotion of feeling loved and supported. It's like the number one thing that influences our health. So your friends and being social, I mean, it's like when you understand that what's more important than smoking. It's like then you really, you know, need to focus, you know, on that too. So anyway, my book goes through all the different, to me, equally important elements, and that if there's really, if you want to have excellent health, you like a holistic approach to it, it's the common thing. And in the back of the book, I do mention these different diseases, you know, like the, you know, diabetes, heart disease, and so forth. And in addition to all the things I talk about in the book that can reverse those and prevent them, there's supplements that I list there that have been shown to be beneficial for those conditions as well. But that's like way in the back of the book, like appendices, you know, kind of thing, because I really wanted the focus to be on how to create health.
Well, I wanted to, you know what, everybody needs to go to drchristinehorner.com so they can get all this goodies and information and buy the book and get the help. And I just want, as we run out of time, I want to say thank you so much for coming on and
sharing. You're so welcome.
Everybody, gratitude, love, and support. Okay. We'll see you next week. Thank you so much, everyone. Bye.